Hi, everyone, and welcome to the first in a series of special episodes of Talks at GS, where we're going to talk with some of the world's greatest investors. I cannot think of anyone better to kick off our series than with George Roberts, who is the co-founder and co-CEO of KKR. So, George, thank you so much for being here.
Well, and thank you, Allison. Thanks for inviting me to be part of this, and thank you for including me.
So, as I was sheltering in place with my family a few months ago, and I was thinking about what this new normal means for all of us, what I really wanted to know was what someone like George Roberts was thinking at the time. So, like early on, first, you know, in the beginning of the year, how did you approach opportunities early in the pandemic? And then I want to talk a little bit about where you're focused now.
Once we were comfortable that people at KKR and our companies were safe, and once we ring-fenced the companies that we have in our portfolio that had issues, liquidity and otherwise, and once we figured that out, we said we need to be out in the offensive. So we said, well, we're going to go after opportunities, and it's been across private equity, infrastructure, some in credit. And, you know, we've used our balance sheet and our capital markets to stand behind the debt that we've had to raise to do what we're doing.
What about across industries? Have you had any particular focus?
Yeah, look, I think that we've had a theme of, you know, where all this fits, you know, when we come out of it. You know, obviously, healthcare tech going to be part of it. You know, telecom, it's going to be huge when we get through this. Also, the industrial sector, probably pretty good. You know, again, taking the view that we cannot analyze what's going to take place in 2020 or 21. But beyond that, it's going to look good.
Have your views on ESG changed at all over the last few months during the crisis?
I don't know if the focus on it has changed. I think that's going to continue, you know, to be on that. I think all of us in our country should be focusing on opportunities and racial justice. You know, what we lack in our country right now is we have a huge opportunity gap. I know everybody talks about wealth gap, but what we have is an opportunity gap. There are people, minorities, that are very, very capable people, but they can't get the foot in the door. And so we have to start creating opportunities for people both in our businesses and outside to get their foot in the door. You know, just put me in the game, coach. Give me a chance. I mean, I was lucky to get an internship job at Bear Stearns. I got a chance. There's so many people that don't get in the game.
So I want to go back now to 1976, when you, Henry Kravis, who is your first cousin, for those who don't know, and your mentor, Jerry Kohlberg from Bear Stearns, got together to form what would now become KKR. What did you want to accomplish with the business at that time? And did you ever think then that you'd end up pioneering an entirely new industry?
We started out with $120,000 of capital, and $100,000 was Jerry's and $10,000 was Henry and mine. So we were just trying to survive. And that's really how we got started. But the basis for starting KKR was really we wanted to work for ourselves and we wanted to build something that was different. Bear Stearns was great to me. It gave me a lot of opportunities. I met Jerry there. Jerry was my boss and my mentor, and I have nothing but great experiences from that. But we wanted something different to do it. So that's why we jumped off the pier and you know, decided, let's see what that's like.
Now, one of the early deals that you were most famous for was RJR Nabisco. And I'm sure you have some great war stories from that era and from that deal. But what were the lessons learned from that experience that you brought forward into your future private equity investments?
There's a quote from Mark Twain, I think, was used in the movie The Big Short. And it goes, it's not what you don't know that gets you in trouble. It's what you know that ain't so. So we had two things in that which we knew that weren't so. And one, we spent a lot of time analyzing the elasticity of the tobacco industry. And all the experts concluded that there was no way that Philip Morris would ever reduce the price of Marlboro. All the analysis showed that they'd be foolish to do that. Well, they did. And that certainly caused some angst in what we had. And then as part of the deal, and that you probably remember this, we had $2 billion of reset notes in our capital structure. So basically, within a period of time, we had to reset those notes to trade at par. And guess what happened? Drexel Burnham went out of business, the high yield market collapsed, and there was no price that you could reset those notes, which meant if we hadn't done it, you wouldn't be sitting here talking to me at KKR today, because I think we would have been out of business. But we figured a way to do it. We got the notes reset. We did some additional financing. The stock went up. When we exited the company, it was more profitable than we went in it. The company had an investment grade record back again. We didn't make any money, but we were still lived to fight another day.
What do you think have personally been the key to your success as an investor?
So I think I was lucky enough one time during the AT&T to be paired with Wayne Gretzky, who was the other amateur in my foursome. And I asked him, I said, you know, you're probably one of the greatest hockey players ever, but nobody gave you credit for being the fastest skater or the, you know, player. What do you attribute your success to? And he said, well, you know, I always skated to where the puck was going. So I think investors have to be a good investor. You have to have enough imagination to realize where the puck might be going, where what does the future look like a little bit in what you do. And that's number one. Number two, I think you have to develop a sense of people. You know, it's individuals that make the difference in a good investment or a bad one, at least in my experience. And getting that right and being able to relate to people and make some judgments on people are far more important than all the financial analysis that young people do today.
So how do you evaluate and assess your younger investment professionals, and how do you differentiate who you think is going to be a really good investor from just an average investor?
One, do they speak up? You know, a lot of people are always afraid to be wrong, you know? And, you know, I'm wrong more times during the day than I'm right, but at least express the views, and I did that from whatever. So I think, you know, making sure that you show up at every meeting you come to with an idea, and don't be afraid to be wrong.
What would you say is the biggest challenge that KKR faces today?
Just executing and performing for our investors.
So your prediction of the S&P 500, will it be higher or lower 1 year from now?
Well, 2 years from now, it'll be higher.
Okay. And a year from now?
2 years from now, it'll be higher.
Okay. China and the U.S., will our relationship be closer or further apart a year from now?
Well, I think that China and the U.S. are going this way. And we're going to have to learn to live with each other. You know, China has its own sovereignty and its own view of the world. And we obviously do with the United States. So I think there's going to be some things that we can agree on and work together on. And there's going to be some major differences.
All right. So my last question for you is, what advice would you have for someone starting out in investing today that you wish someone had given you when you first started in your career?
Look, I was really lucky. I met a guy like Jerry Colbert. And he was a man of principle, integrity, patience. And he gave me a lot of latitude. So I would encourage somebody to find somebody like a Jerry Colbert. that can would really take an interest in them as a person, and would be able to help them.
That's great advice. Thank you so much, George. This was a fascinating talk, and really enjoyed getting your perspectives on the investment landscape.
Thank you.